So, Dr. Scholz, today we're talking about intermittent hormone therapy. And before we go into that, I'd like to kind of discuss the history of intermittent hormone therapy and also kind of what hormone therapy is in general.
So, in a nutshell, hormone therapy means blocking the male hormone testosterone in a patient who has prostate cancer. Prostate cancer cells need testosterone to grow, and medicines that block it cause the cancer to shrink and die. And the idea of intermittent therapy, of course, just as an overview, is the taking a holiday from that treatment and allowing testosterone to come back.
Going back, you know, we have these new scans and everything that we can do there. How did you start knowing, like, where did doctors start doing intermittent hormone therapy? I know, obviously, the treatments came out. Who came up with this concept of, yes, we can pause it?
Yeah, it was, it's fascinating because the use of these medicines, these shots, back in the 1990s was typically reserved only for men that had metastatic disease in their bones. The thought was that the toxicity was excessive and that generally cancer is slow growing, so why not just wait till the cancer got really bad? There was no proof back in the 1990s that men would live longer if they started the hormone treatment at an earlier stage. Now we know that people with serious types of cancer do live longer if they started at an earlier stage, and that policy has become routine. But when we first started giving hormone therapy back in the 1990s, we were quite amazed if the men had earlier stage disease that their PSAs would always go down to undetectable levels and just remain there for extended periods of time. No one knew at that point if those individuals had been cured. So we were some of the early adopters of taking a holiday. Not so much with the idea of resuming treatment later, but just finding out maybe they got cured from the hormone treatment. We later discovered that very few people are cured by hormone therapy alone. And so thus, when they were put back on hormone treatment and their PSAs went back to zero again, it was very comforting to see that the disease remained responsive and that the patients didn't lose any ground from a cancer point of view. Later, large randomized trials were done comparing the outcomes of people that stayed continuously on treatment versus those that took holidays, and they discovered that the 10-year outcomes were identical. Same incidence of hormone resistance, same incidence of people passing away from cancer and other causes. So it has been validated, and I believe there are now 3 large randomized trials that show that same outcome.
So what is the criteria for somebody to go on intermittent hormone therapy?
Well, first you have to already be on it. And the men that are taking hormone therapy, you can think of kind of 2 broad categories. One category is men that are trying to be cured, they're having radiation, and hormone therapy is added for a specified period of time. And when they stop hormone therapy, it's not considered intermittent because they're hoping to have been cured. The men, however, that have relapsed disease, that the doctors figure it's spread, it's not curable, we're going to just control it, hopefully for many, many years, by giving the hormone treatment. Those are the people where the hormone treatment might be stopped, even though we know they're not cured. In other words, take a holiday from the treatment, with the idea that you can go back on treatment again later if the PSA, if and when the PSA starts rising again.
What would a time period of a holiday look like?
Well, it varies from patient to patient, but I would say that it can be as short as 3 to 6 months in an unfavorable situation and as long as 3 to 5 years in a favorable one.
Okay, and what is the monitoring situation during that process?
Our usual policy is to check PSAs every 3 months and and of course check testosterone levels, because when you stop the treatment in elderly men, you never know how long it's going to take for their testicles to wake up. In fact, some individuals, their testicles give up the ghost and they just have indefinitely low testosterone levels. So it's sort of a Pyrrhic victory. There's no real holiday because the testosterone stays down.
So who can't go on like this type of intermittent hormone therapy?
Most people probably that have been on treatment long enough are eligible. But the, in my opinion, I think it's a little bit iffy. If someone can't get their PSA all the way down to undetectable levels, that would be like less than 0.1 or 0.05. Those individuals might even need more treatment, not less, because it's a high, what we call the high PSA nadir is a sign of some hormone resistant cells present. So rather than lightening up and taking time off, it's maybe time to drill down and look at adding treatment to try and make sure that that patient's going to get into a complete remission. So I would stay away from intermittent therapy in people that have high PSA nadirs. The other group of people I'm often asked maybe had radiation and they were put on Lupron as you know for 18 months if they were a high, what we call a high risk patient. And the idea in those individuals is to get cured. And so I've had patients ask me after 6, 8, 10 months and they're tired of the hormone treatment, can I take a holiday? I want to do intermittent. But the goal is to be cured, not to simply suppress the cancer, but eradicate it permanently so it never comes back. And the studies that have been done show that with specified time periods in high risk, 12 to 18 months minimum treatment period, that the cure rates are optimized. So people by going intermittent earlier on could be compromising their chance for cure by taking an early holiday.
Can you define cure for the patients?
Yeah, so I've had patients, in fact, in the early years with prostate cancer, the concept of cure was disputed. There was always the thought, well, prostate cancer is slow growing. It may not come back, you know, in 2 or 3 years, but someday it will, that no one is cured. And that belief was commonplace up to like around the change of the millennium. Finally, studies came out showing people stay cured. And probably the threshold is that if someone's been treated and they're 5 years out from their treatment period and their testosterone is back to normal and their PSA is remaining low and stable, for all intents and purposes, they're cured. There are rare relapses after 5 years, but I think that especially in people that have had radiation compared to surgery, it's more common to see very delayed relapses after surgery, sometimes out to 10 years. But properly treated radiation patients, they rarely relapse after 5 years. So the definition of cure is someone who has had a stable low PSA, not rising, usually less than one, far less than one in most cases, a recovered testosterone, and 5 years of treatment interval since radiation to the present. That's what we would consider someone who's been cured, and the chances of them ever having another problem with prostate cancer is very small.
That's really interesting to me because I think a lot of patients don't get that concept that there is a cure. They either think it's either one and done or it's a multiple thing, but there actually is some middle ground there. One of the questions I'd like to ask is, you know, you've had 25 years plus of experience when it comes to, you know, medical oncology and prostate. So what is the longest, you know, period of time that you've seen a patient, you know, go on and off intermittent therapy and it still keep their PSA down?
Over 20 years. Yeah. Yeah. People, the general average for developing hormone resistance for people that are relapsed after surgery or radiation is about 10 years. But some people, unfortunately, it'll be five. You know, they have got a worse genre of prostate cancer. But in others, they never do develop hormone resistance. So men can truck along. I think actually I have one guy that's pushing close to 25 years now.
What if somebody doesn't want to do intermittent hormone therapy? What if they just want to do continuous hormone therapy? They're concerned about going off. They don't want to deal with the fluctuations. That's fine with you, right?
Yes, it's a lifestyle choice. We know now from the studies that people don't live longer or shorter by taking holidays. So the real issue is how do you want to live your life? Some people are so nervous about their rising PSAs, and some people, these same individuals may also tolerate the low testosterone state well. They exercise, they eat right, they do have a good quality of life. It's perfectly fine if they want to remain on treatment. They have to take precautions against osteoporosis and all the other things that we've talked about. But it's not something where you have to mandate that someone take a holiday, or people that decide that they just like the stable low PSAs on an ongoing basis, and they're willing to put up with the side effects of low testosterone, it's perfectly fine.
Thank you so much for watching. If you would like more information, you can visit our website at pcri.org. Also, subscribe to our YouTube channel. We come out with new prostate cancer videos every week.